You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good morning and welcome to Community Health here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I'm Robin Sings. I'm glad you are here. This is our last session, our last broadcast of the semester. And I'm going to spend some time today just taking a look back at some of the issues that we've addressed that impact the health of a community and what we as health educators and health promoters can do. Certainly, I would invite you to join in on the conversation. We have an 800 number you can call. We have an email address that you can certainly send your comments into. I would certainly appreciate that part of your participation. I think as you who are taking this class for credit here, are reflecting back, what I'd like you to do is to consider this question. What have you learned about community health? How has it changed how you think or what you do? And I'd really like to hear your responses to that. I know that we've talked about lots of foundational issues around health education and around behavior change theories. But then we kind of did a little walkthrough of lots of the different issues that may impact communities. Those of you who are taking this class as well as Health 300, which focuses on health issues in schools, are going to find that the review is very similar. Schools are part of the community. We focus there on what happens with kids. In this particular class, we've really looked at community in a much broader sense. And so I think, you know, there are very similar issues and there may be more far-reaching. So let's just go through a little bit of what we've done. And I'd love to hear kind of where you are as a result of this class. I do just want to give you one quick reminder for those of you who are taking the class. The last exam, it will be available to you beginning at noon. That window of opportunity will close at 11:59 on Monday. So you'll want to make sure to give yourself plenty of time to get in and get that last exam done. Okay, let's take a little memory walk. When we started this semester, we really started with identifying who are health educators. I think so very often we have a very defined picture of who that is, often reminiscent of your high school health teacher, possibly reminiscent of someone who works in a healthcare setting providing information. And really, health educators are those who promote, maintain, and improve individual and community health by assisting individuals and communities to adopt healthy behaviors. So all of us can play a role in being a health educator. Health educators identify a community's need. They plan, implement, and monitor programs that are designed to encourage healthy lifestyles. They may be a resource person for others around health issues. They may be a teacher educating others about those health issues. But bottom line, it's about promoting health, preventing disease and other health problems. So all of us in one way, shape or form can be a health educator. Yes, there are some who have a lot more education, a lot more experience around those issues, around effective interactions, but all of us can play a part. And when we talk about our communities, we really, I encourage you to think of communities in a very broad term. Often when we think, when we hear community health, we think about the health of a city or a region, or maybe even a neighborhood. But a community is defined by us. Our community may be our immediate family. It may be an extended family. It may be those that we work with. It may be those that we worship with. So there are lots of different communities. So what I asked each of you to do during this semester was to identify your community and really assess their needs. You know, what are the health issues that they face? What are the information gaps that they might have? And really we had to look at finding out what their needs are before we take action. We certainly have to consider those cultural norms whenever we are working with any community. They may be our cultural norms or they may be different, but that's all going to have an interplay in what we do as a health educator. So when we think about considerations for health education, what is it that we need to consider before we venture out into this endeavor? First, we need to know what our learners, what our community already knows and thinks, and what they know and think about influences on their health behaviors. So we kind of have to step into their head. We have to understand what they know and think. As health educators, we also need to consider that providing knowledge or functional information is not enough to change behaviors. We also need to recognize that health does not occur in a vacuum. Whatever we are encouraging others to do as far as engage in healthier behaviors is going to be influenced by their family, their friends, their community, their income, their social norms, a variety of factors. So, you know, we step into our community's head, kind of get a feel for what they think and know. We understand that we have to give them more than just the facts. And we understand that we have to recognize there are lots of influences on changing health behaviors. There are many others who have theorized about how you change behavior. And in the text that we've used this semester, we've really looked at the theory of planned behavior. We need to consider the attitudes of our learner. How much does our learner care about the outcome of changing a behavior? We have to consider the subjective or social norms. What is the peer pressure that changes a behavior or keeps an unhealthy behavior going? And then does our learner perceive that they can do it? Do they have some control? Are they confident that they can engage in a healthier behavior? So that whole theory of planned behavior is forcing us to think, okay, before our individual community changes a behavior, we need to address their attitudes. We need to address social norms and try to influence those to a healthier behavior. And then we have to give our learners the confidence to act, the confidence to engage in that behavior. Okay, so that kind of lays the foundation for where we go, what we do, if we are going to, in fact, try to change some of the health status of our community. We really need to define our audience. And this whole issue of community health can be so vague and so misinterpreted. So we really define our audience. Who is it that you really are looking to change behaviors? What are their ages? What languages do they speak? What gender? What cultural background? What are their attitudes and prior knowledge? When we define our audience, that helps us then go into using print materials to support our conversations. We can talk with individuals about health topics for quite some time. It's always a good idea to have that print material, something you can leave with them so that they can go back and review what you've talked about. Many individuals are visual learners, so often those print materials are going to help us do that. And then defining our audience and knowing the print resources that might be available, whether electronic or actually on hard copy paper, then we can design what we want to do. And so when we look at health education, we're really looking at a blend of this behavior change and the theoretical basis around that, and strong education. Helping our learner get hooked into what it is we want to talk about with them. We need to engage them in the process of learning. We can't just give them a whole bunch of information and walk away and assume that things will happen. We need to present the information in a way that's organized and accepted and understood. We need to provide an opportunity for the learner or the learners to practice so that they can be confident in what they may be changing, what behaviors they want to engage in. So really, when we're looking at community health issues, it is knowing the issues, but it's also knowing our audience and knowing what resources we have to work with them and knowing how we're going to design that event, that lesson, that intervention in a way that will engage them and hopefully motivate them to change those behaviors. So once we kind of talked about that, then we really looked at a variety of health behaviors that we see in lots of communities that if we were to do something, we might actually improve the health of that community, whoever that community is. So we kind of went through a whole variety. You'll remember way back at the beginning of the semester, we talked about personal and community health, really focused on hand washing as the behavior that really does reduce the risk of the spread of infections. So let's revisit a video clip that we saw early in the semester entitled "Clean Hands Help Prevent the Flu."
Try and avoid sneezing into your hand because you just contaminate them and then spread those germs everywhere. Focus on sneezing into your elbow, like this, and then you don't contaminate your hands. Turn on the water, wet your hands, apply a good amount of soap and lather up, and then focus on washing your hands for about 20 seconds, about the time it takes to sing Happy Birthday twice. Focus on washing the front of your hands, the back, in between the fingers, around the nails, and so on. And then rinse everything off. Use something to wipe your hands after that, preferably something disposable like a paper towel, and then use that to turn off the tap as well. If you get a chance, use that to also open the door to the bathroom as you're leaving. The best way to wash your hands is using running water and soap, but sometimes we don't have that available. So think about carrying with you a hand sanitizer. That should have at least 60% alcohol content.
For more information, visit www.cdc.gov.
Okay. Washing hands, and the next issue we talked about was making sure we had appropriate immunizations, including the flu shots. And if you'll remember, we had a guest speaker who talked about the importance of flu shots. And really, that's a great example of trying to address a community's attitudes around flu shots, their understanding of what they are and their importance. Addressing some of the cultural issues around getting flu shots. Again, those are a couple of really simple things that we could encourage in our communities that really do make a difference, whether your community is based in a household or in many households, in a neighborhood or across a city. We did talk a little bit about dental health. Most of us don't think a lot about brushing our teeth. We certainly do need to. Certainly a connection between dental health and heart health, dental health and social health. We know that, cavities are the most chronic health problem you will find, particularly in children. And there are lots of easy ways to alleviate that. Not only brushing, flossing, but water fluoridation. So working with city water departments and then visiting a dentist on a regular basis for screening. We also talked about sun safety as an issue that could be brought into improve the health of a community. The risk for skin cancer is significant. It's one of the few cancers we see on the increase. So we talked about some simple strategies to address within a community. Everything from cover up and seek shade to avoid the sun between 10 a.m. and 4 p.m. Avoid tanning beds, use sunglasses, and use sunscreen. We also talked about one of the other health issues that we see in many communities, particularly here in Southern California, and that was the issue of asthma. Certainly, we know that we are in a constant state of spring, summer, and fall, which means the pollen counts often are very high. We are in an industrialized area, so we certainly have to deal with some environmental pollutants. But even things within our own homes, our own apartments, our own school classrooms, that might trigger asthma in an individual, which certainly impacts their ability to function. So we can certainly work with our community around removing some of the triggers for asthma, if that is a health issue of concern. Everything from removing carpet, making sure that dust is at a minimum, not using strong cleaning agents, not having pets in the house. Those are all things that we could build a teaching learning event, a lesson, an intervention around that would improve the health of an individual with asthma, which then improves their health in the community. We also talked about mental, emotional, and social health. And certainly, the ability to perceive reality as it is and to respond to challenges and to develop rational strategies for living is important in any community. We know that the stigma around mental health disorders is significant. So significant that many individuals who may feel that they are having problems are very concerned about seeking help because they may be outcast. And we certainly know that while the stigma is great, the need for treatment and support is even greater. We do know that family mental health problems increase the risk for having that as an individual. So certainly if you're seeing mental health problems in the community in which you've defined, that's a risk factor for others in that community, particularly if you're looking at family-based communities. We certainly know that we all deal with stress on a daily basis. It's a body's response to the environment. There's good stress and there's not so good stress, but it's really helping communities learn how to cope effectively with any kind of stress. We also did talk a little bit about depression. It can be caused by a physical illness. There are biochemical factors. There is hereditary component to that. We certainly know that depression can impact our communities significantly. Suicide is another issue that may frequently come up. And whether that's a suicide that gets a lot of attention through the media, through the social circles, or whether it's a suicide in a family that where there's little talk about it. We know that substances certainly can play a role in that. We need to be very aware of some of those telltale signs and symptoms of an individual considering suicide, so that we can provide them support.
things like giving away prized possessions, that focus on death as the only way out. And very often individuals who are in this type of space are not considering other alternatives. They see this as the only. We as a health educator in that community can help them see that there are other options, that there are others who can help. And then we also talked a little bit about eating disorders, another mental health issue that it varies from time to time, whether it's out in the open or whether it's one of those hidden, stigmatized mental health issues. Certainly we all as health educators need to know about anorexia, which is that extreme food limiting. The body just becomes emaciated. Or the bulimia, which is the excessive consumption, often paired with the purging to get rid of some of those calories. So we know that all of those mental health disorders are part of any community. They often are hidden, and so we certainly want to work with our community to say, it's okay to talk about these kinds of things. I know that, in today's culture, we certainly are worried and considering the mental health of our vets, and know that the post-traumatic stress that they confront after experiencing the traumas of conflict and war are significant. We don't want to let anyone in our community feel that they are isolated. Them to know that we are there, we care, and there are others that can help. We also talked about nutrition and physical activity. This is one of those health issues that I think we get a lot of press on lately. Communities are very aware of the issues of obesity, eating too much and not being active enough. Cities are very involved in increasing the walkability of neighborhoods, increasing the access to parks and activities in parks. Schools are certainly looking at food issues as well as activity. But I do also think we need to think about hunger and malnutrition in our communities. We don't want to focus just on the obesity issue. There are many in our communities who are chronically hungry. They have very limited access to foods, or they are eating foods that are calorie rich, but nutrient absent. They may look fine, they may not look like they have any lack of nutrition, but they're not getting the nutrients they need. And we focused a lot on food insecurity, that often linked to poverty, individuals who just don't have enough food or enough money to get the food. So we highlighted some of the resources that are available in California. As a health educator, you are there to be a resource, a link. So often knowing about what's available in your communities, in your health departments, in your Department of Social Services, you can provide a lot of information, a lot of connection to help them to change, to improve that community health. We all know about the Dietary Guidelines for Americans and My Plate and reading food labels. There's been a big push for all of this since the Dietary Guidelines came out in 2010, really helping our communities understand the importance of eating balanced food, eating foods that are nutrient rich, eating more fruits and vegetables, and watching out for hidden fats, salts, and sugars. Let's take a look at a video clip called Rethink Your Drink, The Rule of Four.
I'm thirsty.
Dibs on soda.
Okay. You're kidding me.
What?
Soda is off the chain.
Besides you, they're my best friend. Oh.
I can't believe you. Do you know what's in a can of soda? 40 grams of sugar in one can.
Is that a lot?
Just remember the rule of four. There are 4 grams of sugar in every teaspoon.
So what? I'm supposed to do math now?
40 grams divided by 4 equals 10 teaspoons.
Oh, that is a lot. Juice is chill, right? Yo, this has 24 grams of sugar.
24 divided by 4 equals 6 teaspoons of sugar. But it's only half as big as that can.
What am I supposed to drink? Water?
Yeah, I love it. Remember the rule of 4 and rethink your drink. Choose water.
I showed you several different campaigns around a variety of health issues just to get little tidbits of information to maybe motivate our community to engage in healthier behaviors. I want to just take a quick break. I've been doing a lot of review. I don't see any comments up on the screen, but I want to remind you, if you would like to share your thoughts about what you've learned about your community or what you've done or how it's changed about what you've thought about your community, please give me a call or send me that email and let me know in the little bit of time that we have left. I'd love to hear your thoughts on that. Okay, all right, let's keep going while I'm waiting for something to come up on the screen. We did talk about a lot of different health issues that impact your community. And I tried to organize those into some of the categories that we often work around in public health with risk behaviors. One of those categories is alcohol, tobacco, and other drugs. Certainly lots of media around it, and for many years, lots of different campaigns around avoiding drugs. But I think it's really important for all of us who want to think about ourselves as a health educator or as a promoter of health in our community that we recognize first and foremost what a drug is. A drug is any substance that changes how our body works. It's not just the illegal drugs. It's anything that changes how our body works. So it's the over-the-counter medications, the prescription medications, caffeine, tobacco, alcohol, marijuana. It's the all of the illegal drugs. It's herbs. It's volatile gases and chemicals. A lot of different things in our communities impact how our bodies work, how we function. And I think we need to recognize that. And again, looking at attitudes around use. What are the social norms? Is it seen as acceptable? And how do we address those attitudes and those social norms when we know that the research behind so much of this is that it's not a healthy behavior? We know that drug use is that chronic, excessive use of a drug. It's often the drugs are intended to be used in a way to change how we feel, how we work. It's an illegal use. Bottom line, it's detrimental to health. So certainly we need to address drug abuse issues in our community. We have to understand the issue of tolerance. Drug tolerance is that sensitivity to a drug. You know, when we use a particular substance over time, that the sensitivity, our body responds to that. It lowers the sensitivity. So actually it requires more of a drug for the same impact, for the same response. So often what you'll hear in a community is, well, I used to only have one or two, now I need two or three or four to get the same impact. And certainly we know that drug abuse is detrimental. You know, it's continuing to do harm. We have to think about our community. We have to know our community to know what are the drugs that are being used. You know, is it the gateway drugs, alcohol, tobacco, marijuana? Or is it issues around illegal drugs, inhalants, et cetera? Let's talk a little bit about tobacco, because I do remember we had several conversations around tobacco products and are there safe alternatives. Remember that nearly 90% of adult tobacco users start before the age of 18. This is a behavior that individuals engage in at a very early age and for a very long time. The risk factors that we look for in communities are parents who smoke. That puts their children at greater risk for smoking. Individuals with body image concerns may likely turn to tobacco as an alternative to putting food in their mouth. They're using tobacco as an alternative. And then, of course, in any community where the perceived norms are those that it's acceptable, it's not a big deal, and if it's available, it's easily accessible, those are all risk factors for tobacco use. Now, we know in California there's been a lot of education going on around tobacco. The tar, that brown sticky substance that settles in the lungs as we smoke, that's what creates a smoker's cough. The nicotine, that addictive drug in the tobacco. And then, of course, carbon monoxide, which is the most harmful substance because it inhibits our blood getting oxygen. Those are all components of tobacco use. So I know that we've certainly seen some issues around safe alternatives and the promotion of electronic cigarettes or electronic delivery devices being a safe alternative. We found out that's not. We know hookahs are not a safe alternative. They may be taking out one of the substances in tobacco, but certainly not all. I mean, you're talking about electronic cigarettes, you're talking about a nicotine delivery system. May not have the tar, may not have the carbon monoxide effect, but still it's got the nicotine, and there may be other chemicals. Hookah may water filter some of it out, but certainly not all. And the whole idea of tobacco use in any shape, way, and form is important because of the kids around tobacco users. Secondhand smoke is a real health issue for those who are around tobacco users. It exacerbates asthma. Certainly it's linked to upper respiratory infections, ear infections, chronic cough as well. So let's take a look at a video clip just to remind us about tobacco use around children.
I smoke when I'm watching cartoons.
Yeah. I have my first cigarette of the day when I get up.
We smoke in the car on the way to school.
I smoke while I'm coloring.
I smoke during my nap.
When you smoke around your kids,
I'm down to about a pack a day.
It's like they're smoking. Secondhand smoke can hurt their lung growth and permanently damage lung functions.
I tried quitting. I need to try again.
Okay, just remember our kids. And one of the things that we talked about, and I think we all recognize, is that scare tactics do not change behavior. We really are working with providing individuals in our community with information, helping them understand and change attitudes around those negative behaviors. Changing some of the social norms in a community, those are tough things to do, but we certainly know that, you know, just using the scary pictures, using the threats, won't change that behavior. We talked a lot about alcohol use. It's the most commonly abused substance during adolescence, and it is legal for adults to use. It is often misused and for many abused. We know that alcohol certainly plays a role in many motor vehicle crashes, in violence, in crime, depression, and suicide. So it's not just about the drinking, but there's also a very strong mental health component to that as well. And individuals, those who are using alcohol, misusing it or abusing it, need to understand the consequences of use and the impact, particularly long-term use, but they also need to understand the issue of addiction and how very strong that issue of addiction is, whether it's with alcohol, tobacco, or another substance. And this is really where we as health educators and promoters can play a role in helping individuals understand that using substances is not a necessity. It's not a normal part of life. That we can certainly go on to think about it as self-abusive behaviors. We're hurting ourselves. This is also an issue where we certainly need to remember that we can't do it all. There are individuals who are going to need to be there to help us. And so often our work in a community around substance use and around mental health disorders is going to be connecting with other healthcare providers, other treatment facilities. But it's our role is helping those individuals in our community understand the need for treatment. Okay, and let's see, I've got a comment up on the screen. Let me take a look and read and see what this one has to do about. Mitch is writing in, newly discovered MERSCO virus. It's the Middle East Respiratory Syndrome is a virus it's been around in the Middle East a while. It's come to light because now we have a case of it in the U.S. And wondering if we can scroll down. What would be best addressed? Let's see. Okay, can you describe some of the significant community health issues we should be paying attention to as opposed to the hysteria that may have already begun in the media? Good question. I think, you know, this is an issue, it really relates back to what we were talking about under personal and community health. This is a virus, just as many others. It is a difficult virus to treat. So we're really looking at the importance of prevention or risk reduction, and that's washing hands. It's a respiratory virus, so it's covering mouth and face when coughing and sneezing. And really what I've seen a little bit differently in this one, as it is getting out as a community health issue, is folks are bringing it to highlight in the media. But they are trying to do a little bit more of a balance of the hysteria isn't necessarily going to help us. And so really talking about this is an isolated case here. We don't have a vaccine or a treatment for it at this point, but it's really about taking care of ourselves, building up strong, healthy bodies beforehand. I think it's really important that when we as health educators in a community hear things. I think, first of all, it's important that we listen to what's going on in the media. You need to know what people in the general population are hearing, because often that's where it all gets started. And they actually have talked a fair amount of this about this in the media with the MERS virus, is that, you know, many of us have seen the movies like Contagion, where it's very dramatized and it does build the hysteria. Don't think about what you've seen in the movies. Know that the Centers for Disease Control are really looking at this and really trying to minimize hysteria, because hysteria is one of those things that gets in the way of action. And so, again, as a health educator in your community, you can be that voice of calm, that voice of reason. Listen to individuals' concerns. Research the information, get the facts, so that you can share accurate information in your community. You can give tips for reducing the risk of the spread of any respiratory virus and go from there. So I hope that kind of answered that question. Is there anything else on the screen? I'm not seeing anything come up. Okay. There we go. All right, let's go on. We did talk a lot about community health around the issues of injury. There are those that are unintentional injuries or accidents. They're preventable and they are predictable. Motor vehicle crashes being the leading cause of death and injuries in this country across multiple age groups. And we really need to look at accident prevention, again, from that analytical kind of perspective, looking at the potential for accidents, the potential for injury, and alleviating some of those, teaching safety skills, really taking more of a positive approach. Whoops, I'm over there. It's all about choice and responsibility. We have a personal choice in the behaviors that we engage in. And we want to encourage responsibility. We want to encourage individuals to respect not only themselves, but to others. And really looking at diminishing some of the risk for those accidents. And we talked about lots of different areas that those accidents take place in. It's really being very aware of our community and what the needs are. We also did talk a little bit about violence and the intentional injury. We focused on bullying because that certainly got a lot of media attention. And I think in a community, you have the chance to really change some social norms around bullying. There are times that we have often referred to bullying as, well, it's boys being boys, or mean girls going through a stage. It's a normal part of growing up. I was bullied, I survived. We've got to get rid of some of those attitudes, some of those norms, and say, bullying is aggression. Bullying is violence. And really looking at standing up and saying, no, it's not okay to do that. We also looked at sexual harassment. Certainly, I think in workplace and military, we've heard about sexual harassment, but you're hearing more and more about it in schools, in community settings, in neighborhoods. Really understanding the two types of sexual harassment, quid pro quo, something for something, or hostile environment. And this is really looking at sexual jokes, comments, grabbing, graffiti, all of those kinds of things. That is, it's a violation of law. And so certainly as a community health educator, we're in a position that we can not only share that information, but provide those who deal with these acts of violence the resources to take action so that they don't remain a victim, but actually can do something to attempt to stop those behaviors. We also talked a little bit in a couple of weeks ago about growth, development, and sexual health within a community. Really focusing on lifespan. Really focusing on understanding that we all go through these stages of life, what they are, and what we need to do to take care of ourselves. I think in many communities, there's a strong focus on preventing teen pregnancy or preventing unintended pregnancy in young adults, and also preventing sexually transmitted infections. And what we saw in a lot of the data that we reviewed is that teen pregnancies are certainly going down. Unintended pregnancies are going down. Folks are getting the information, they're having positive attitudes around hormonal birth control in the fact that we see those birth rates going down. Unfortunately, and we had a speaker from our public health department in Long Beach come, really talking about the increase in sexually transmitted infections. And even though we've been talking about HIV for many, many years, and chlamydia and gonorrhea and all of the others, really looking at the importance of everyone understanding that condom use is a very effective way of preventing those sexually transmitted infections. So for many individuals, they're having to look at dual protection, protection against pregnancy, but also protection against unintended pregnancy. And really looking at what happens in schools, because that's one of those venues where we can actually teach young adults, adolescents, about what's going on in their bodies, those appropriate relationships, and delaying the onset of sexual activity. Getting that clear message of abstinence out there, but also getting the message about risk reduction, preventing pregnancies and sexually transmitted diseases. We know that across most communities, most individuals are very supportive of that kind of instruction going on in schools. We can reinforce that instruction in home and our communities and really get those messages out. And certainly while we may be focused on teens, those messages need to be heard, and those attitudes need to be addressed in adult populations as well. We do know that we are also seeing an increase in sexually transmitted infections in some of our older age groups. They're not worried about pregnancy anymore, but they still need to be worried about sexually transmitted infections. And then we spent our last time together talking about loss and grief and death. And certainly, you know, these issues have implications on many levels in your community. So whether you are thinking about your community defined as your family or your friends or your neighborhood or your workplace, the issues of loss and grief and death will occur, undoubtedly. We know that the portrayal of death is so misleading and confusing in our culture. And so very often individuals don't have a good understanding of that. There are also a lot of controversial issues about how one should behave when one encounters a loss or when one is grieving. We really need to be careful as health educators not to impose our personal values or beliefs on our community about what you should and shouldn't do. But we're there to really help them understand what these issues are. And remember that in all communities, again, because of the presence of media, many of us experience that loss and that grief. Many of us see death through the media. We may not have as many encounters in our family or in our little community, but because we are connected to the world, we see what happens from everything from 9/11 to horrific motor vehicle crashes to the casualties of conflict and war. I think, so we need to be prepared as health educators, as promoters of health, to help our individuals in the community understand what all of this is. So that means we have to understand those stages of how we all take in death, how we all understand death. We know that our little ones in our neighborhoods, in our communities, they don't understand that death is final. They see it as going to sleep, going away, taking a trip. So there's always that expectation of someone waking up or coming back. So knowing that that is a stage within our stage of understanding, that's a specific community within our community that we may need to work with and support. We know that some of our older children, our 5 to 9 year olds, start to understand that there is something that causes death. There's some external entity. For many, they're going to consider that the boogeyman or God. And very often, this is the age group that is going to experience guilt when they see someone die, whether it's someone they know or someone through the media. So we have to be able to work with that population or with the parents of that population. And then once we hit pre-puberty, 9, 10, 11, most of us understand that death is final, that death is something that causes the body to stop working. And very often this is when we start to have some very strong emotions around death. So remember that you might be that resource person in a community that's experiencing loss. that's grieving a tragedy in a neighborhood. You know, if they're experienced, if they're part of a community, they've experienced a very visible loss. So certainly understanding grieving is going to be important. And so we can help them understand grieving. And very often these stages of grief, we've now associated with the stages of death and dying. Denial, very often when these issues come up, the first thing we want to do is deny that it happened. That's usually our first response to a significant event. I can't believe it. I'm sure that information is wrong. Show me more evidence. Certainly a very strong emotion to deal with when we deal with grief. And that can last up to 2 weeks for many individuals. So it's a very long process. Typically, that second stage of grief is really about experiencing everything from numbness to guilt to sadness. Lots of strong emotions there. Then as we work through those, going into the next stage being really where we recover, we kind of get back to some normal activities. And through that all, we as health educators want to be there to support individuals. Very often, if we can be the individual who's a little less connected to the loss or grief, we're not in the midst of it. So we can be there to reflect back to individuals what they are feeling and that it's normal, it's okay. And then look at some activities to remember individuals that they've lost or are grieving. Deal with the tragedies that they see in the media and kind of come to some understanding about some of that. So I think we've really talked about a lot of content over the course of a semester. And it's a very much a quick review. I hope that you've been able to glean some from the text and from some of the websites and from some of the documents that I've posted on Blackboard for you so that you save those as a resource for your future encounters. Those of us who are interested in being health promoters and health educators, you never know what you're going to be dealing with, what issue, what audience, or the circumstances around them. So really, it's about understanding some of those foundations that we started out with. You know, we need to have that functional knowledge, that information, but we need to help folks work through that so that it's not just giving them information and walking away, but we're helping them access their own information, process their own influences, make decisions, talk through it, communicate, and then really practice some of those behaviors. We really are dealing not only with the individual, but with many individuals in recognizing there are social norms around everything that we do. If those social norms support unhealthy behaviors, we really need to work with a much broader audience to get that to the point of encouraging folks to think about considering changing to a healthier behavior before they'll actually get down that road and go from that. You know, I asked all of you who are taking the class to create some teaching learning event for a community that you defined and pull in some resources that you found. And I think each one of you, those that I have already read, were able to do that. Some of you defined family members who may be using tobacco as the community that you wanted to work with. Found some great resources online and in print, and then really kind of outlined what you need to do. Some of you were working with younger children. Some of you, I think one of you were was talking about working with a group of veterans. And some of you are working with elderly, some of you are working with teens around teen prevention, teen pregnancy prevention, sexually transmitted infection prevention, all of those issues. So each one of you was able to define your audience and recognize the nuances of that audience, to find some resources that you could draw from, and then come up with some activities. Sometimes those activities are very brief. Sometimes they may be over several minutes. And sometimes there are multiple interactions. That's okay. Every engagement of health education is unique. And it's really dependent on knowing your audience and meeting their needs. So I do hope that the activities that you did through the semester, the readings, the written activities that you selected, you'll actually be able to implement. I didn't require that you implemented them. I just required that you designed them. But I hope that you will look at those activities, that work that you did, and see if you can put it into practice. I know that there are only a few of you in the class who are actually community health majors, that the majority of you are from a variety of backgrounds and just wanting to know some more general information about that. And I think that is an excellent source for you to draw from in your daily activities. So I hope that you'll be able to use those at some point. Okay, so I've got just a couple of questions in the last couple of minutes. What community health issues, in your opinion, should be prioritized in the long term, particularly during the summer? You know, June, I think that is dependent on the community in which you live and that in which you define. Every community is going to be different. There are some very broad issues, but I'm talking about looking at your community in a manner in which you can have an influence. So I think that's depending on looking at your community, however you define your community. Okay, I think that's all I have time for today. I want to just remind all of you that the last exam will be open to you in just a few minutes. And I will be communicating with all of you by email. If you have any last minute questions, please get those to me. I hope that you have been able to take something away this semester and that you will use it with your community to improve that community's health. So here is wishing each of you health, peace, and happiness. I will hope to see you around. Take care. Bye-bye.